Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The basis for our meditation this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Out of Egypt I called my son. This is the word of the Lord. It was a dreaded part of growing up. Chores, jobs, household duties, whatever you called them, were disliked. Many a child has thought to themselves that old Ma and Pa decided to have kids just so they could have some free labor. Even when the task was small, it always seemed unfair that parents, whenever they wanted to, could tell you to do whatever they wanted. And so children everywhere developed a plan to retaliate. It is entitled, Doing as Little as Possible to Meet the Requirements of Completing the Task. The letter of the law is followed, but the spirit of the law is abandoned. Cleaning the room involves stuffing everything into the closet, but when mom opens the door, the response is, well, you didn't tell me to clean the closet. The waste baskets in the upper floor were my task as a child. Traveling from the second story all the way to the basement seemed to be an overly tedious way of getting rid of the trash, so occasionally I just flushed it down the toilet. I dreamed of a house with a laundry chute, but put the garbage can underneath, and I would never have to carry another basket down two whole flights of stairs again. Mother and father had three choices when the duties assigned were not completed to their satisfaction. They could choose to overlook it, shrug their shoulders, and just hope for better next time. They could punish, bring out the dreaded spanking spoon, or they could call for replacements, assigning to another sibling what had been left undone. God decided to do all three. Out of Egypt, I have called my son. God's son was called out by God to be faithful, to enter the promised land and destroy all enemies. But when the first son didn't fulfill the task, when the first son may have failed miserably, God shrugged his shoulders, beat that first son, and called in his second son to do what had been left undone. To grasp the consequence of it all, hear me out. The promised land was just that, a land not yet theirs, but had God's promise attached that it would be theirs one day. The promise was given to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. And in our Old Testament lesson for today, we hear the account of a man in trouble. His name is Jacob, or Israel. It's the same person. He's dwelling in the land of promise that will one day be his descendants, but there is a problem. There's a great famine in the land, and if he stays there, his family will starve to death. Yet God appears to him in a dream at night and says, go, get out, go to Egypt, dwell there. When it's time, I will call you back. You'll be there for a while, 400 years to be exact, but the time will come when I will call my son out of Egypt to return to the very land now under your feet. Out of Egypt, I will call my son. So Jacob went, he and his 12 sons and their sons went and dwelt in Egypt, in the land of Goshen and the fertile delta of the Nile River. At first, things were great as they lived there as shepherds. But a time came when a Pharaoh arose who realized the potential of this foreign people. He made them his slaves. They were whipped and oppressed, and they were forced to make bricks and houses in the hot Egyptian sun. And they cried out to their God, and after 400 years, he delivered them. He sent Moses who brought them out, and he told Pharaoh, you have taken my firstborn son and refused to let him go, so now I will take your firstborn son. They crossed the Red Sea, and the host of Pharaoh met their end when the seas engulfed them. They made a pit stop at Mount Sinai, where God gave them 10 directions for the way. After all that he had done for them, rescuing them from slavery, when they had no way to deliver themselves, he only expected this in return. Follow me, love me, have no other gods. Only I can save you. Believe and trust in me alone. I will help you. As I have done for you now, so I will continue to do. Be my people. If I have done this great thing for you, if I have shown you my ability, then you know that nothing can harm you, my people. Cross the desert, pass over the Jordan, enter the land that I have promised, and put to death all the peoples who are living in your land, so their false gods are not a snare to you. But instead, we know the story. They sacrificed to the golden calf, grumbled and complained at every turn, and each time adversity struck, believed that God had left them there to die. And finally, when they got to the Jordan and went across it, they failed to put an end to all their enemies, but worshiped their gods instead. These enemies were a thorn in the side of Israel for the rest of their days. Out of Egypt, I have called my son. Out of Egypt, I have rescued him, delivered him, saved him. But with what thanks has he repaid me? It was Yogi Berra who once said, it's deja vu all over again. Deja vu is when what has happened seems already to have happened. Did you ever notice that the life of Jesus consistently parallels the life of Israel? Just as Jacob and his family fled to Egypt to protect their lives, so this morning we read that it happened to Jesus too, and both times God appeared in a dream to warn them. And just as he called them out of Egypt to return to the land, so he called the Holy Family out of Egypt once the time was right to go back to the promised land. But what does it all mean? Is it only a mere twist of fate or chance? As we look at Jesus' life, we might say, it seems like we have been down this path before. Simply, though, it's just the story of the second son, the replacement. The story is similar, just a different son and a different ending. One did what the other failed to do. God sent his other son as the replacement to complete the job and to finish the task. Is it mere coincidence that just as they were in the wilderness for 40 years, so Jesus enters the wilderness for 40 days? Is it sheer happenstance that while they were unfaithful against the temptations of the devil there in the wilderness, we see that Jesus was tempted over and over by the devil and was there victorious? They wanted bread, and they got manna, yet were soon tired of it when he gave it. Yet Jesus was content with eating no bread, but living from the word of his Father alone. They tempted God to destroy them with their incessant complaining. Yet Jesus held fast to the Father's word and would not tempt the Lord his God. The Israelites bowed down to the golden calf and every other foreign god along the way. But Jesus, even when he was offered the entire world by the devil, said, it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Is it simply coincidental that just as they passed through the Jordan in the Old Testament, so he also passes through those waters? It is not a coincidence. Jesus is the faithful son. Jesus enters the Jordan River to be baptized by John, and he exits the water on the other side to enter to the promised land to do the work of defeating the enemy and dying on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins. The Holy Spirit in the form of a dove comes down from heaven and remains on Jesus as the Father cries out these words, this is my beloved Son. With him I am well pleased. Out of Egypt I have called my son. The first son just didn't cut the mustard. But there is a third son, and that son is you. Is it merely a coincidence that the journeys of God's son Israel and God's son Jesus mirror your journeys? For you were in Egypt too, in slavery to sin, death, and the power of the devil, and you were unable to save yourself. Born in sin and under the power of the devil, because of your inherited and corrupt and selfish nature, you worked for an even more wicked Pharaoh, the devil, serving him day and night in his prison until he might bring you to the clutches of eternal death in hell. But just as the Israelites were brought through the Red Sea, and through that sea their enemies were drowned, and their old way of life was put behind them, so you were baptized in the mighty heavenly waters of the baptismal font, brought through the saving waters of the Red Sea, the true Red Sea, by water in God's word, baptized into Jesus' blood. In that sea, all the host of your enemies, because of Christ's death for you, lost their power. Your sins were forgiven in Jesus' name, and you were bestowed an eternal inheritance and made to be a child, a son of God. And after that water was the wilderness. And in that wilderness of life, you live now, biding your time until the 40 or so years of your life are complete, until you cross over the Jordan and enter that promised land. As you enter the land promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, so that you might inherit your promised rest, heaven, that you might wait for a restored creation where the wolf will lie down with the lamb. But that rest, you should know, is not attained through your own merit, your own striving, your trust in yourself, or your own work. For you are not the faithful son. You are the rebellious one. For look at your life in the wilderness just this past week, and even in the first days of this year. You've lived as if God did not matter and as if you mattered most. Your Lord's name you have not honored as you should, and your worship and prayers have faltered. You have not let his love have its way with you, and so your love for others has failed. There are those that you have hurt. There are those that you have failed to help, and your thoughts and your desires have been soiled with sin. Yet he has rescued you out of bondage, from slavery, and he has provided for your every need. And with what thanks do you repay him? Have you trusted or believed in him, even though he has shown the sign of his mercy in the gift of the child of Bethlehem? No. If there is hope for the promised land, it must be in the one who was called out of Egypt, who was faithful in the wilderness, who crossed the Jordan to enter into the promised land, so that the enemy that occupied that territory might be once and for all defeated. That son in his death, on that bloody pole and gibbet outside Jerusalem, defeated your enemies, forgave your sins, made you holy, restored your sonship, and won for you a land without boundary, without end, and without price. Out of Egypt I have called my son. He called Israel, he called Jesus, and he calls you. Think of it, he calls you. Over and over and over, he calls you out of Egypt, delivers you from your slavery to your pet sins, calls you away from your failure to trust him, drowns your enemies through the word of his forgiveness, and brings you on the firm land of his promises on the other side. You are slaves no longer. He has freed you from sin, death, and woe. He has freed you as his sons and daughters to serve him day and night in the difficult life in this forsaken wilderness. Your enemies are now behind you and threaten you no more. Your promise lies ahead. Live in his kingdom as the son that you are, forsaking the desire to trust in your own merits or goodness, clinging instead to Jesus and finding alone in him your salvation. And so the wastebaskets are empty, and the closet is spick and span. God called in the replacement. The job which you have failed to do has been done by your brother Jesus. And if you have Jesus as your brother, then God must be your father. And if you have God as your father, that must mean that you are his dearly loved son. And if you are his dearly loved son, then indeed you are an heir. And if you are an heir, then the inheritance is yours. And if the inheritance is yours, then soon and very soon, you will follow Jesus. You will cross the Jordan in death, and you will inherit the land flowing with milk and honey, which will have no end. In this Christmas season, we give thanks to God, for he has, as the words of Galatians 4, verse 4 say, sent forth his son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. The peace of God, which passes all human understanding, guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus.